This is not Sunday as usual. There is a move of God. We are all going to be changed when we leave up out of here. Who am I talking to? We are going to be new when we leave up out of here. We're going to be different when we leave up out of here. Because there is a fresh wind of anointing and there's a move of God with your name on it. Somebody give him praise one more time. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Good morning, Freedom Movement Church. Good morning, Freedom Movement Church. It is good to see everybody. Everybody looks so refreshed. You got an extra hour of sleep. Some of y'all in the back down in the meeting a whole lot. There's some folk that just praising and dancing over an hour of sleep. Hallelujah. It is so good to be in the house one more time, and God is moving. Before we go any further, we just want to acknowledge if there are any visitors, first-time guests, raise your hand that we would see your hand. Any visitors, first-time guests? Yes, I see your hand. I see your hand. Let's give God praise. Yes. Amen. On behalf of myself, Pastor Jeff, and my beautiful wife, Teresa, and the whole entire Freedom Movement Church, we want to welcome you to Freedom Movement. You could have been anywhere else on this Sunday morning, but I believe it was God's hand that led you here. And I believe there's a special blessing for you today in Jesus' name. We're looking forward to what the Lord has in store. And we just want to tell you this. If you, since you are a first-time visitor and guest, the ushers are going to give you a card for you to fill out so we can come and get to know you. And you can just put it in the offering box and give it back to an usher. And we're believing by faith that the Lord is going to move and have his way. You are seated next to people who are crazy about God and love God. And we love you. And we're believing for the fullness of God's purpose and destiny on your life. If you believe it, somebody say, it is so.
It is so.
In Jesus' name. So I need somebody here just to give our awesome visitors, whether you are visiting here, which I see you, but there are some visitors online. I see you too. And we praise God for you. We're going to give you a warm, courteous Freedom Movement welcome on the count of three. One, two, three, go! You feel that love? My goodness. Brother's about to be like, thank you, thank you, thank you. Good gracious, I know that's right. God is so good. Listen, we're embarking in a new sermon series. Amen. I'm very excited about this, and we are going to follow the Holy Spirit's lead. Can we do that? We're following the Holy Spirit's lead. Sometimes I have things listed that I intend to talk about, and the Holy Spirit comes and does a divine disruption. And he says, Jeff, that's fine and that's good, but I want you to say this to my people. So we are going to be led by the Lord. I can tell you right now, I don't even know how long this series is going to be. But I'm just going to say, Lord, I'm going to preach it as long as you give it to me to preach. Hallelujah. This series is simply called Identity Crisis. Identity crisis. Mm-hmm. Identity crisis. Now more than ever is it crucial for the people of God not only to be where they're supposed to be, but to know who they are.
Amen.
Because sometimes you can be where you're supposed to be, but if you don't really know who you are, you won't be fully fruitful in where you're supposed to be. We ain't even preaching yet. We got to get to the text first. Are you seeing this? But this is an imperative for the end times that the people of God know exactly who they are. So we're going to examine this. And listen, I'm going to do something. I don't do this very often, but the Lord has led me. Listen, in this text we are about to read, God says, I want you to preach this text in two parts. Are you hearing this? So this is not only part one of the series, but this is part one of this text that I'm about to read. And we're going to have part two of the same text next week. Is that okay?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Because God says, yep, you could get it all today, but I need you to take your time with the people so they can understand what it means to walk in identity.
Yes, sir.
Amen?
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. I need us to open up our Bibles. Yes, yes. To the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 16. And I'll be reading from verses 13 through verse 19, English Standard Version. I need everybody to stand right where you are. If all who are blessed and able to be able to stand, hallelujah. Even if you're not able to stand, you're still blessed.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Everybody stand to your feet for the reading and the hearing of the word. Hallelujah. Matthew chapter 16, verse 13 through 19. Hallelujah. You got homework that you got to study this text because you know this is not going to be a surprise pop quiz. Next week, we're going to talk about the same thing.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 19. Let me acknowledge this before we go into the text. Can we give God praise for our worship leader, Elizabeth? Let's give God praise for her. Hallelujah. There is a kind of anointing and worship leading that makes preaching easy.
Yeah.
You ain't got to fight in the atmosphere.
Yeah.
This is the kind of atmosphere you got to keep up with God. Say, hold up, hold up, hold up, now, hold up. Because it's so thick in here in a good way. Hallelujah.
Yes, all right.
Woo, God. Matthew chapter 16. Verses 13 through 19. You have to say amen.
Amen.
It reads as follows. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. He said to them, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter replied, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, my God, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. The devil can't stop this thing. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven.
Amen.
And whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. And the people of God said amen.
Amen.
I need you to look at your neighbor to your left and say, neighbor,
yeah.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So glad you're here.
Yeah.
I've got a word for you.
You are
who God says you are. Look at your other neighbor to the right and say, neighbor, so glad you're here. You're at the right place at the right time. But I have a word for you. You are who God says you are. Oh, if you receive it, somebody clap your hands and give him glory right now. Everybody remain standing. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We honor you. We give you glory. We give you praise. You are the only wise God, and we give you the glory and thank you for blessing us with your word. Thank you for seeing fit to speak and deposit and impart into our spirits for a time such as this. Lord, we ask that you would speak like never before. Use me. Hide me behind your cross. Fresh anointing fall fresh. That it will fall on good ground and that it would accomplish the very thing that you have a purpose for it to do before the foundation of the world. Father, give us eyes to see. Give us ears to hear. Give us hearts to receive like never before, that we would never be the same again. We believe you by faith that you would teach us, instruct us, convict us, motivate us, transform us, free us, Lord God, empower us to walk into purpose and destiny that you have called us to walk in. And it's already done in Jesus' name. We thank you in advance that there's no devil in hell that can stop the move that you have ordained before the foundation of the world. We thank you, God, that this is unstoppable move. And we give you the glory, and we give you the praise, and we stand on your word and your promise. believe you by faith that it's already done. So Spirit of the living God, we ask that you speak, Lord. Your servants are listening. We give you the glory and give you the praise. We ask it all in Jesus' name. People of God, shout it, amen. You may take your seats. You may take your seats. You are who God says you are. Hallelujah. I believe by faith one of the greatest battles that you can face in your life is the battle of identity. Did y'all hear what I said? Hallelujah. One of the greatest battles that you could face in your life is the battle of identity. See, y'all didn't realize that identity is a battle. What do you mean? It doesn't start when you're an adult. Identity battles start when you're young. Anybody heard of peer pressure? Peer pressure is simply an identity battle. What? Are you scared? You got to prove that you are this or that. And you got to do this or that. And if you don't do this or that, then you ain't cool. Then you ain't got it like that. Huh? Anybody ever been in an identity battle in a relationship? If you love me, you compromise.
Come on now. Come on.
I'm talking to the wrong crowd. It's okay. But I find that battle becomes an if the identity can be a battle. You know why? Here's why. Can we go a little bit deeper with this? The Bible says in the Gospel of Luke chapter 6, verse 45, a man does good out of the good stored in his heart. And a man also does evil from the evil that's stored in his heart. From the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And that's just a fancy way of saying that your actions flow out of your identity. Yeah. Is that true? So in other words, if you want to know who somebody is, all you got to do is listen to them. And over time, they'll tell you exactly who they are. Because the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. So this is why the enemy's plan for you is to steal, kill, and destroy. He can't kill you and he can't destroy you because he does not have the authority to do it. So what he wants to do, he wants to provide you an identity crisis.
My Lord.
Are you listening? He wants to provide you an identity crisis. What's an identity crisis? I'm glad you asked. You can write down this working definition. The identity crisis is simply a period of uncertainty and confusion in which a person's sense of identity becomes insecure. Well, let me say that again. My goodness. Identity crisis. Anybody ever been there? A period of uncertainty and confusion in which a person's sense of identity becomes insecure. This explains the attack on your life. The attack on your life is because the enemy wants you to have uncertainty and confusion about your identity. Because if you have uncertainty, confusion, and insecurity, you can't obey God right. If you walk in uncertainty, confusion, and insecurity, you'll run and try to be something that you're not. If you run in uncertainty, confusion, and insecurity, you'll be running and changing your identity like a chameleon to blend in with people instead of pleasing God. It got quiet. Are you hearing this? So the enemy, he wants to give you an identity crisis. Y'all not believing me. Can we take it to the word? Let's take it to the word. You remember Adam and Eve? They was minding their own business. They were free, naming animals, walking around, just chilling. Flesh of my flesh, bone of my bone. Gotta love it. Ain't that right? Yeah. Until the enemy showed up and said, did God say for you to not eat of that one tree? You got everything else. It's amazing that the enemy always wants to talk about the one thing he can't do. Are you seeing it? And he says, watch this, Teresa. They said, nope, we can't eat the tree because we'll die. You know what the enemy said to them? He says, you will not surely die, you will be. Read your Bible. Genesis chapter 3, you will be like gods, knowing good and evil. So the first temptation that man faced was over identity. And the enemy says, this is who you are going to be, and they fell for it. Are you seeing this? And this is why you have to be careful, because when the enemy is tempting you, he's not tempting you to do something. He's tempting you to be something. Let me say it again. I think y'all missed it. When the enemy is coming against you, he's not trying to make you do something different. He's trying to make you be something different. That's why you can't flirt with sin.
Come on.
You ever met somebody that's flirt? Know how to flirt? Sometimes the flirt, they don't mean no harm. They just give off a little something. Are you so crazy? Okay, sweater. Okay, shirt. That's how people be doing. They don't even say, you look, okay, pants. That's how people be these days. That's the new level of, just call the thing. Oh, you doing it, you got it going on. And sometimes you'll put stuff out there, and we're like that with sin. And you have to understand, you flirting with sin, but sin trying to kill you. You flirt, you dibble dabble. Oh, you so crazy devil. I know I shouldn't do that, but let me just a little sip. You crazy. But after all the while, there's a hit on your life because the devil is after your identity. Why is he after your identity? I'm glad you asked, because the devil knows fully well, if you only knew who you really were, the devil wouldn't be able to stand a chance. If you knew how much power you had in the Holy Spirit, you would not be deceived. You would not be duped. You would not be tricked. You will be able to stand in power, and you can say, the devil is a liar, and the word of God is true, and this is what I stand on. But you have to understand, if the devil can't kill you, and if he can't take you out, he can put you in an identity crisis so you can do everything else in your life except know who you are. And you're left chasing after stuff that don't even match your real name. What good is it when you finally get it? It ain't even you anyway. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And this is where we have to understand that there is an identity crisis. So we've got to watch how we step and watch how we move. Because we don't want to get caught up in something that we kind of flirt with. Because God, the devil is saying, I want you to do it so much that it becomes who you are. That it takes control of your life. And now you're a slave to it. But you were not born to be a slave. You were born to be a servant. A slave is in bondage. A servant is free to serve the Lord. A slave can't go where he needs to go. But a servant is a child of the King, who he's anointed and appointed to serve God and to worship him only. You've got to be careful, because there's an identity crisis that the enemy is doing for your life. But how many know he's defeated in Jesus' name?
Amen.
Are you hearing this? Can we walk this out? Can we walk this out? So I want you to write this down. This is, sometimes you're wondering, well, how can I guard myself against falling into the enemy's identity crisis? Here's how you can do it. I want you to write this very simple point down. And God says, I want you to make this as simple and plain as possible so that people can catch it. Are y'all ready? This is how you know when you're being tempted by God, or tempted by the devil, or spoken to by God. Here it is, very simple. The enemy calls you by your past, and God calls you by your future. Let me say it one more time. The enemy calls you by your past, and God calls you by your future. This is very, very important. So when you can discern who is trying to lead in your life, if the thing that's trying to lead in your life is drawing you back to who you used to be, that means that's the enemy speaking into your life. If the thing that is trying to lead your life is to put you with the old crowd, the old way of thinking, the old mindset, the old thing that you miss so much, chances are the enemy is trying to keep you somewhere, and you know where the voice is coming from. But when God calls you, God doesn't call you who you used to be. God doesn't even call you who you are. God calls you who you're going to be. And sometimes it's hard to recognize because you don't understand who you're going to be. So sometimes when God calls you by name, you do one of these. You talking to me? Because you don't quite understand it, because the thing that God is calling you in your future doesn't match your present, and it definitely don't match your past. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So God has a way of calling you by your future. You have to understand, when David was in the sheepfold minding his own business, God led Samuel and said, pour the oil on his life. He didn't say, now he's going to be king in a few years. He said he's king right now, because I already speak to his future. If God can look at Gideon shaking in his boots, hiding, and say, mighty man of valor, he's not speaking to where you are. He's not speaking to what you're going through. He's speaking to the finished product. That's why you can have confidence that when God calls you by name, he's taking you to where he needs to go. Because it's your future, but it's actually God's past. Yeah. Can I talk to somebody here? And I'm encouraging you, so when you walk in identity, you can be confident of it. Because when God speaks to your future, it's future only to you, but it's past to God. Because God is not telling you what he's going to do in the future. He's telling you what he's already done. He's just waiting for you to catch up to it. All you got to do is catch up to it. Why are you worried about what God is calling you to do? Why are you fearful? All you got to do is catch up to it. I've already done it. Just catch up to it. God, are you feeling what I'm saying? And once you realize who God is speaking, you understand that is your identity, and you'll follow it because you know that this is how God is moving. This is not only a word, and we're going to get into the text. This is not only a word, my God, this messed me up. See, sometimes, watch this, we know, everybody knows that you can't be stuck in your past, right? We know that. Yep, the enemy calls you by your past. You're not supposed to be doing that. We also know that God calls you by your future. You know what God told me? He said, Jeff, don't get stuck in your present. Did y'all hear what I said? Yep. Don't get stuck in the past. Hear my voice for your future. But in order for you to get your future, you can't be stuck in your present. Oh, who am I talking to? See, I'm not only talking to people who are struggling with a thing, trying to get out of a sin. I'm talking to the folk that have prayed and God answered your prayer and opened the door and you walked through the door. And you were broke, but now you are walking in financial breakthrough because you're honoring the principles of God. And you've already borne fruit because you have obeyed God. I'm talking to you because he says, listen, I know you are not your past, but you have to understand I'm just getting started. So don't get comfortable in slight progress. And God says, I'm only getting started, because many of us will walk through a few doors and think we have arrived and think that we have been. Now we tithe every week. We got it all figured out. Nope, there is something more. I'm talking to the faithful saints that you show up on time and you give God praise and you do what you're supposed to do. I don't often talk to you. I often talk to folk who are struggling. Who are the people who are thriving and doing what God says do? God told me to tell you, don't get stuck in your present, because greater is coming. Don't get stuck in it, because greater is coming. And sometimes we can get comfortable and say, this is what's up. We start to judge other people. How come you're not where I'm at? I mean, I'm doing this, and how come? Nope, you ain't got time for that. You got to pour into them. You got to keep moving forward, because this is not the fullness of who you are. I know you've experienced some fruit, but some of y'all are about to go through the pruning process where more fruit is going to come. More fruit is going to happen. More things are going to happen. And the fullness of your identity is coming to pass. I just tell you, if you're obeying God, I dare you to buckle up your seatbelt, because there's something in the spirit realm that's going to be deposited in your life, and you're going to move forward in purpose and destiny. Don't get stuck in your present. Because your present, even though you've grown, is not the fullness of your real name. Do you hear what I say? It's not the fullness of your real name. Oh, I need somebody to receive this. Somebody say, greater is coming. I don't think you believe it. You just said it because the preacher said it. I want it to be a confirmation of already reverberating in your spirit. Somebody say, greater is coming. Clap your hands if you receive it. End of the day, you are who God says you are. There's a text that we need to walk through because the enemy wants to not only teach us who we are, but he also wants to teach us how to walk in who we are. Sometimes the definition of who we are isn't all there is to it, but there has to be practice and teaching of how to walk in who we are. Isn't that right? So we're believing God that in this text, that he is going to give us pointers on how to walk in who we are. Amen. So, there are keys right here. We get to this very well-known text. When Jesus, he came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, and he asked his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? Because he was fully aware that he was in people's presence and in people's vicinity. He was working miracle signs and wonders. He was teaching like never before. And people were this close to him, but still didn't know who he was. Isn't that crazy? For Jesus to be that close to you and you not even recognize him. Somebody's living that out in 2022. You got situations. And God is looking at you saying, really? I'm this close to you and you can't even see me for who I am? I'm working so much in your life. Can you imagine? That's crazy for you to have Jesus in this kind of distance where you can touch him and people still had misunderstanding about his identity. Isn't that crazy? But what does it look like that we walk by faith and not by sight? And God is surely moving, and some things God is doing, he's revealing himself this close, and we still crying out as if we don't know where he is. Wow. Are you hearing what I'm saying? But watch this. He says there are some lessons on identity that I want you to grasp because you're going to need it in order to walk into your destiny, to walk into your future. You do understand this is your season of purpose. This is your season of purpose. There's some things that you've been through for the last 20, 30 years that have prepared you for this moment. Amen. Good, bad, and ugly. Yes. That's why you don't be ashamed of any of it. Amen. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You're being prepared for your season of purpose. This is the time where you are going to do exactly what God created you to do. Yes. Isn't it wonderful to live your life and you can look at God at the end of your life and God say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Because there's going to be two camps. There's going to be people who do the will of God. People are going to be saying, and God is going to say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Or he's going to say, depart from me, evildoer. I never knew you. Wow. Which camp do we want to be in? Somebody say amen. Amen. But watch this. He asked this question. We're going to teach this a little bit, and then we're going to shift. He asked this very relevant question. He said, who do the people say that the Son of Man is? And look what they say, verse 14. And they said, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And this leads me to believe that they put a label on him based on what they saw with their naked eye. Yeah. Amen. Can I teach this? Is this okay?
Right.
Based on what they can perceive with their human senses, they made a decision about who he was. So many times, if they're calling him a prophet, chances are they heard his teaching. Are you hearing it?
Yeah.
And they had an experience with what he could do. So since they saw a side of what he could do, they concluded this must be who he is. Yeah. Are you here? But point number one, I need you to write this down. Mm-hmm. Never prioritize experiencing God over knowing God. Let me say it again. See, y'all missed it. Never prioritize experiencing God over knowing God. It's right there in the text. See, the people that encountered Jesus gave him a label and a name based on their experience. Isn't that right? But they didn't get the fullness of who he are, who he was, because they only saw one side of him. And sometimes we've got to be careful by giving God a label based on one side that we've seen of him. Because there's a difference between experiencing God and knowing God. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And it's very important that we don't just seek God for the experience and never seek God for the knowledge of his identity. Am I teaching okay? This is important because you can tell that people who only can label God by experience is when they pray, they only want God to do something for them. Wow. Man, it's about to get tight up in here. You can tell that the relationship is based on experience because I prayed and you're supposed to answer and do something for me because I've seen you do something. And I'm calling you by what you do. And you've got to be careful. You've got to be careful because can I tell you this very well-known secret? The key of you knowing who you are is really knowing who God is. That's the key. And you will, when you will short-circuit your own destiny by never knowing who God really is because you only had him as an experience and you're only looking for him to heal because you've seen him heal before and you need something done for you and you say, God, could you hook me up? You can tell when folk only know him by experience because they get an attitude when he don't move like he's supposed to move. You're supposed to be a healer. Lord, what happened? What happened? Are you hearing what I'm saying? But there is a difference, watch this, between experiencing God and knowing God. Can I talk about it? See, if you just experience God, you'll show up at church hoping to have something happen. But when you know God, you've already had church at your own house. And you've had praise and worship. You didn't wait for Elizabeth to tell you to open up your mouth and give God praise. You were praising God in the car. You had to pull over on the side because the song got good to you. Because I'm not worshiping what I experienced. I'm worshiping that I know. Yep, I know he can do it. But at the end of the day, he's a good, good father. He's perfect in all of his ways. There's a difference between experiencing God and knowing God. Yep, when I experience God, I pray for him to do a certain thing, but I'll catch feelings if he's not moving like I want him to do. But when you know God, we know that he is on his own time, and he's moving when he gets ready to move. And we know that he's ordering our steps, and the fact that he's not moving is that sometimes he is waiting and seeing if we trust him for real, and we're not just looking like that. I'm glad sometimes that God don't move every time we say boo. Yeah. What would the body of Christ look like if God just answered every single prayer? You would just come in. We'd be the most spoilers brats you can think of. Throwing a temper tantrum and rolling around the floor. All of a sudden, God say, okay, Bobby, I'll do it. That's not who God is. It's the difference between experiencing him and knowing him. And when you experience him, yes, he's shown a dimension of himself, but don't box him in to that one dimension that you've seen. God is not just a healer. He's also a deliverer. God is not just a deliverer. He's also a waymaker. God is not just a waymaker. He's also a strong tower. God is not only a strong tower. He's also a miracle worker. God is not only a miracle worker, he's a joy. Not only is he joy, but he's peace. Not only is he peace, he's power. Not only is his power, he's victory. And when God revealed himself to Moses, he says, you know what? Who do you think that I sent you? I want to give you the full picture. The full picture is my name is I Am That I Am. So the people that experience God only know him as a teacher. But the people that know God know him as I am that I am. The people that experience God might know him to be a deliverer. But the people that know God, they know him to be I am that I am. I will be whatever you need me to be. You need me to be a heart fixer? I am. You need me to be a mind regulator? I am. You need me to come through for you when nobody else can? I am. You need me to be a friend? don't just settle for having an experience with God, but do you come to know God for who he is? Because the Bible says, let us make man in our image and in our likeness. Are you seeing what I'm saying? Watch this. Oh, let's go to this. Oh, Lord, help us, Lord. Watch what he said. Verse 13, y'all still in the Bible? Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? There's a part that you might have missed in verse 13 that's very important. See, now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, let me stop there. Bible scholars, when you are studying the Bible, never take any words of the Bible for granted. Preachers, never take any of the words of the Bible for granted, because there's revelation in every word. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You think at random, this is Caesarea Philippi, but Caesarea Philippi is significant, because if you look at the text, it's not that the fact of God asking them, who do they say that I am? It's about where he asked them. Can we talk about it? See, at the time, in the New Testament time, Caesarea Philippi was a pagan location. Oh, wow. This was a place where sacrifices were made to idols, and they worshiped a god called Pan. But many people even called the place Panion, because it was a place that a pagan god was worshiped. And it was a place where it was so much anti-God and anti-Christ. But God waited to get to a place where the people around him were against him, and it was right there where he asked, who do man say that he is? Are you hearing what I'm saying? Point number two, write this down. Never let convenience distract your confession. Can we unpack this real quick? I'm trying to teach this, y'all. Tim, I'm trying to teach this, man. Never let convenience distract your confession. What do you mean? Jesus waited to the most paganistic, unholy possible place that they can go through. And at that moment, he stopped right where they were against him, right where they weren't talking about him, right where they didn't have a heart for him, and say, who do you say that I am? How many know it's easy to say Jesus is Lord in church? But can you say Jesus is Lord when they're cussing at your job? Yeah. It's easy to say that Jesus is Lord when the choir is singing. It's easy to say Jesus is Lord when the pastor is preaching. But what do you do when you get around your family members and there's liquor bottles on the table and y'all playing spades and all kind of stuff? What do you say then about Jesus? Somebody say amen. And the true confession of faith in your life is not always just what you say, but where you say it. Are you hearing what I'm saying? All right, I got to stop here. I got a confession to make. I got a transparent moment. Can I have a transparent moment? Y'all got to promise you're not going to judge me. Did y'all promise? Some of y'all say, no, I'm still going to judge you, Pastor. Anybody ever heard the phrase code switching? Okay, here's my confession. I be code switching. I feel the judgment. I be code switching. I do. When somebody's wondering what code switching is, in case y'all wondering, code switching is the ability to speak various language in bursts in certain conversations. I be code switching. The doors of the church are open. Anybody else can be doing it. Y'all can come and y'all can stand with Pastor. See, I'm going to give you an example. This is, I'm going to give you an example of 45 seconds at my job. Okay, I'm just going to tell you how it goes. Good morning. My weekend was great. How was yours? Oh, that's wonderful. Okay, I'll see you later. Okay. Bruh, you good? Yeah. You see that game, man? That was crazy. Hey, Jeff, how was church? Oh, it was awesome. It was great. We had people came out, and we had a great time in God. It was a blessing. Hey, I appreciate you asking that. Okay. Yo, man, it was dope. Oh, God, we moved. You know what I'm saying? You know. I'll be code switching. And I'm about to go to D.C. Today. I'm going to D.C. to visit my parents for a couple of days. Here they know I'm coming. And I can guarantee you that when I get there, I'm going to see some of the people I grew up with, and my accent is going to change. Okay? It's going to change. I'm sorry. It's going to change. Y'all judging me, but I'm going to sound a little different when I'm up there. I'm down here. Hey, what's up? Y'all good? What's going on? Up there? Yo, what's up, bro? Yeah, what's up, yo? You? Yeah, I can't call it, man. The Washington Commanders, man. I don't know. It's going to be a different world because my D.C. going to come out. Are you hearing me? And I'll be code switching. Y'all got to pray for me. But here's the thing about my code switching. All my switching is authentic. Let's not get it twisted. Good morning, how are you? Is a part of me. Bro, you good? Is a part of me. The D.C. accent is a part of me. So my code switching is not me faking. It's just me switching up when I got to switch up. Are y'all feel what I'm saying? Some of the code switchers in the room. You ain't got to just say amen. Just look straight so I don't know who you are. I see some code switchers in the room. Amen. See, Jesus says, be cautious that you don't become a spiritual code switcher. What do you mean by a spiritual code switcher? I'm glad you asked. Because it's one thing to say, hey, good morning, how are you? And to say, yo, what's up, what's going on? It's another thing to be in church talking about God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. But be at your house talking about you ain't beep, and I wish you were beep, beep. And come see me because of the beep, beep, beep. I'm tired of your beep, 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 beep. Because sometimes, that's why God had to bring him to Caesarea Philippi. Because he says, I know you're walking with me now, but what are you going to do when you're around the folk that don't know me and don't love me? Are you going to take a stand for me, or are you going to code switch? Are you going to take a name and say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord, or will you sound like the heathens and sound like the people that need deliverance, even though you've been deliverance, because you're so pressed to fit in with every crowd? You'll code switch so you can be comfortable, and now you are called to walk in the light. But what do you do when the people you need the light for can't even see your light? Because your spiritual code switching is putting them back in the dark. Because code switching, sometimes you can have authentic facets of your life, but some of your codes might not be true to who you really are. And God is only honoring the code based on what's really in your heart.
Oh, yes. That's good.
So the true test of your confession is when you can do it when it's unpopular. I promise you, at Caesarea Philippi, wasn't nobody talking about bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Huh? When at Caesarea Philippi, they weren't on none of that. But can you still be on purpose and still be a light when nobody else is? Are you hearing what I'm saying? Because sometimes your friend group, the group chat, ain't on Jesus. And sometimes you try to blend in, but God says you got to be about my business when it's convenient or when it's not. I know it's convenient in the church. I know it's convenient around the pastor. I know it's convenient in your small group. I know it's convenient in the prayer time. But is it convenient in the house when you're around your girls, when y'all going out on Friday night? Where is your Jesus? And Jesus gives you himself. And I promise you, his aim and his purpose for you not to just have Jesus in the church. And we do ourselves a disservice, people of God, when we confine our Jesus to a building.
Wow.
You got good Jesus up in 1148 JBL Court. I'm going to give you this slow clap for your Jesus. But what does your Jesus look like at the grocery store? What does your Jesus look like when you get upset? What does your Jesus look like in your marriage? If there's a disconnect and a disagreement, God says, I love you too much for you to code switch. Somebody say amen. Amen. And this is when we are walking in identity and you so strong in it, you don't care what people think. Amen. Anybody there yet? Some of y'all, okay, a couple people are there. You'll eventually get to that place in your life. And I suggest you do it sooner and later when you get delivered from what people think about you. If you got to be popular, you got to be liked, you got to have 55, 64 likes and comments and all these kinds, you have to have love and hearts going on your stories. If you're that kind of person, yeah, I don't know, that Jesus confession ain't all about that. What if you don't get any likes? Will you get the mad face on Facebook because you forget about Jesus? Will you still serve him? What if somebody ostracize you and your family and say, you a Jesus freak, you changed, you different. Why, you are all brand new. And you say, thank you for the compliment. I am brand new. I am a new creature. Yes, old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Thank you. How you doing? I appreciate you seeing the newness of life I'm walking in. You can laugh all you want to, but I'm praising God because I'm brand new. You can talk about me all you want to, but I'm praising God that I'm walking with him and not with the devil. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And we've got to get to the point. It doesn't matter who's around. I've decided to make Jesus my choice. Like, clap your hands and give God praise if you believe it. Hallelujah. A major stumbling block for many Christians is convenience. Yeah. Especially after the pandemic, boy. Ooh. Like, man, I'm kind of used to the stay-at-home TV. Church, that's all right. I stay in my pajamas and roll over and watch some of it and go to sleep. And sometimes convenience is taking over where you used to press your way through. You used to get up and come no matter what. You used to get up because you knew that there was a move of God. If you could just get through, if you could get through the tiredness of your week, if you could get through the conflict and the struggle and the voices, if you could press your way, I may come limping in, but I'm praising my way. Don't let convenience be the distraction of your destiny. Somebody say amen. Hallelujah. I got one more thing. Hallelujah. We got to go. I told you if I preached all of this text, we'd be here to about 3:30. And that is not of God. Is it? Okay. Get your hand says, no, you're right, Pastor. First time she said, you're right. Yeah. I got it. Baby. All right. Watch this. So watch what he said. They said John the Baptist, others Jeremiah's. Okay. That's fine, but who do you say that I am? Yeah. Because the confession of faith that gets you to a heaven is not your grandmama's, it's yours. Yeah, I know they're a member of the church, but the confession that gets you to God is not theirs, it's yours. So he says, I understand who they say, and they had it twisted, but at the end of the day, who do you say that I am? Can we look here? Look at what he said. This was a general question to the whole group. There was 12 of them to the whole group. Of course, in Simon Peter fashion, he spoke up. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Simon wasn't perfect, but he's a leader. Amen? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him, blessed are you. I want you to get this, y'all. This is so much revelation. Simon Peter replied, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter. I'm going to stop there. Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And now, since you have lifted up my name, I'm going to tell you your name. All right, I'm giving it away. Wow. Point number three, please write this down. Your fulfillment is connected to your faith. Amen. Let me say it again. Your fulfillment is connected to your faith. This is a big piece of identity. A lot of times people are seeking something so they can achieve fulfillment. Is that right? Yeah. And sometimes if something is not fulfilling, people are chasing fulfillment. Yeah. as an identity. This is very important. A lot of times the enemy promises fulfillment in things that aren't fulfilling. And this is what sin and temptation is. It's a promise of fulfillment in something that doesn't have the ability to fulfill. Are y'all hearing me? I'm trying to teach this. But watch this. Your fulfillment is connected to your faith. Look at verse 17. The first thing Jesus said was, blessed are you. Do y'all see it? Yeah. Blessed are you. What is he talking about? You blessed? Is that money in your pocket? Does that mean blessed that you got a new house? Is it blessed that you got some new friends? Blessed that you hooked up with your spouse? Is that what this blessed means? No. If you look in the Greek, it's the Greek word makarios. And the word makarios means to be fully satisfied. So as soon as Peter called him Jesus the Christ, Jesus the Christ called him fully satisfied.
Can I say
one more time? As soon as he called Jesus the Christ, Jesus the Christ called him fully satisfied. Because your fulfillment is connected to your faith. Fully satisfied are you. Some of y'all are saying, yeah, I know, I love Jesus, but I ain't fully satisfied with my life. Yeah, I know, I said he was, I know he's the Christ, but how come I'm not really happy with the way things are going? Because sometimes you have missed what God has already given you. Sometimes we're looking for something that the world has, and we've seen that the world defines as fulfillment, and we'll chase after that. And God says, you have chased so much farther than you had to because I've already given you what you're chasing after as soon as you said yes to Jesus Christ. All this time, you all tired and out of breath. What you doing? Chasing after that stuff, chasing after that money. The grind don't stop. If you sleeping, you ain't work. The devil is a liar. Stop chasing after that stuff and start chasing after God. God already said you were fully satisfied. So why are you trying to find it in a man? God said you were fully satisfied. Why are you trying to find it in a job? God said you were already fully satisfied. Why are you trying to find it in a group of friends? At the end of the day, your satisfaction is wrapped up in your confession of faith. As soon as God revealed himself to you, not only did he give you everlasting life, but he gave you full satisfaction on earth. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Okay, I need to go deeper, Teresa, because I don't think people understand. They don't quite get what just happened and what Peter said. Do you realize what Peter said? See, sometimes there's some things that you can say out of your flesh because that's how you feel in the moment. But there's something that you can't say unless the Spirit of God is in you. There's something that you can't say unless God chooses you to say it. You do realize when you made a confession of faith, that wasn't your choice, it was God's choice. Y'all, okay, can I say that again? Okay, can we get some theology here? Ephesians chapter 1, we were chosen in him before the foundation of the world to be blameless in his sight. This was not just a choice we randomly made because we were in a good church service, but God chose us before he created the heavens and earth. He chose us before the water was flowing. He chose us before the animals came here. And the fact that you made a confession of faith, you caught up to what God already decided. And I don't know how hard your life is, but could you imagine your life without God? I know you're going through some struggles, but could you imagine your life without being filled with the Holy Ghost? I know you got some things that aren't working out, but could you imagine if God wasn't able to keep you in your mind, keep you in your body, keep you and you're still here? And you have to realize when you make confession of faith, do you understand what you said yes to? So many of us only talk about, yeah, when you follow God, the warfare gets harder and harder. When you do what God says, oh man, everybody's going to hate you. And folks be like, I don't know if I want to sign up for that. Can I tell you another side? When you say yes to Jesus Christ, there is a peace that you have that the world can't give and the world can't take away. when you follow up with Jesus Christ, there is a hedge of protection around you. And I know the enemy is attacking you, but you can see the unseen dangers, the thing that was trying to come against you, but God moved it out the way even before you got it, because you had a mark of a man of God on your life, and you could not be hurt. You could not be killed. You would not be crushed. When you are walking with God, you got promises over your life. If you would just say yes to the promises of God, they will come to pass in your life. When you said yes to God, he said the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. And though he fall, there's grace and mercy. He will not utterly be cast down, but God will uphold him with his right hand. David said it like this: I was young, but I'm old. But I have never seen the righteous forsaken or a seed begging bread. He said he will supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory. When Jesus said pray, say, give us this day our daily bread. Am I talking to somebody? Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it already is, as it's already done, as it's already worked out, as it's already said, as it's already made, as it's already open, as it's already supplied. Am I talking to somebody in this room? You sitting there pouting about the money, but you gotta be glad about the Messiah. You sitting there mad about what's wrong, but be glad your name is written in the book of life, because at the end of the day, you are fully satisfied. You may not have all the zeros, but you're fully satisfied. You might be by yourself in your apartment, but you are fully satisfied, because if you have God, that's all you need. I need somebody to shout if you're grateful for what you have. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
I wish salvation carried as much weight as your storm. I wish the presence of God had more weight than the problems of man. Oh, I wish. What if the weight of the glory was enough to get you out of your depression? What if the presence of God was enough to get your mind to joy out of being discouraged? What if God's word that he spoke, for we know all things work together for good, as soon as it popped in your spirit, it changed your countenance. This is what God intended. And I'm afraid that in the modern day Christianity, the weight is unbalanced, because your storms and your issues seem to have more weight than the Messiah and the one that's for you. Because God said, if God be for you, who can be against you? So why does the things against you have so much weight if God says they can't really be against you if I'm for you? I need somebody to walk in satisfaction.
Amen.
I need somebody to stop. See, y'all laugh when y'all was young, because the old folk used to say stuff like, when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me. Some people would say, my soul cry out. Some people say, when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, I just dance all night. Don't get me started. We ain't got no organ. We ain't got a drummer. We ain't got nothing. But there's a song in my heart when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me. I can push past my issues. I can push past my ailments. I can push past my sickness. I can push past my doubts. I can push past my fear. I can push past my insecurities. I can push past my circumstances. I can push past it all, and I can still give God a praise. Because all I gotta do is think. All I gotta do is just think, and I have a dance. If I can think, I can have a shout. If I would just think, I will have a victory. I dare somebody, that's your mentality is, I know I'm going through, but all I gotta do is think. I dare. I need somebody right quick I know we don't have an organ. I need somebody to think right quick. And you realize that, man, I thought I had it bad. But I started thinking of how good God is. I thought I had it rough. And I began to think of how good God is. When I think of the goodness of Jesus. I dare you.
Hallelujah.
Everybody stand to your feet right now. Everybody stand to your feet. Woo! I need everybody to stand to your feet right now.